Connection with Intuit, Mr. Gates, insofar as you are aware, was there any effort to get Intuit to agree that Intuit would not promote Netscape's browser?
I'm not aware of anything specifically related to promotion. As I said, I didn't deal with them directly. You could say that asking them not to support Netscape as their standard supported browser is a change in their promotion of Netscape.
yes, I take that point. Let me make the question a little more precise. Other than an attempt to get Intuit to make Internet Explorer Intuit's default browser, did Microsoft make any effort that you're aware of to get Intuit not to support or advertise Netscape's browser?
It's kind of a strange question because Intuit never would have specifically advertised someone's browser. So I don't know what do you mean by promotion when you give that example.
Well, I'm really just asking for what Microsoft did. And if you don't understand the question, Mr. Gates, you can tell me and I will rephrase the question.
Isn't that what I just did?
Saying that you didn't understand the question?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let me put another question to you. Did Microsoft, insofar as you are aware, try to get Intuit to agree not to enter into any kind of marketing or promotion agreements with Netscape?
I don't know.
Did you have discussions with anyone concerning what Microsoft was trying to get from Intuit?
I might have sent email about it at some point.
Remember the content of that email?
No.
Remember anything at all about the content of that email?
Well, I don't know that it's an email either. I said I might have sent email. It may have been many emails. So no, I don't remember anything beyond the fact that there may have been email about this, and I may have made my views about the subject known.
Let me ask you to look at a document that has been previously marked as Government Exhibit 376. This purports to be a email dated April 17, 1997 from Brad Chase to you and some other people, which is forwarding on a email of earlier in the day on April 17th from Mr. Will Poole to Brad Chase. The subject of both emails is Intuit terms agreed. Do you see that?
Well, it's just a forward, yeah.
Do you recall receiving this email?
No.
Do you have any doubt that you received a copy of this email?
No.
There are...
Well, I don't have any reason to doubt. I don't know that I received the email. I don't have any reason to doubt it. But since I don't remember it,
did you ever see this email before?
I don't remember ever seeing it.
Under the heading Intuit Obligations, it says Bundle IE3, Quicken, in parentheses, and IE4 in parentheses, other products. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Were you told in April 1997 that Intuit had agreed to bundle IE3 and IE4 with its products?
I don't remember that specifically.
Farther down, under Intuit obligations, there is an obligation that reads, quote, not enter into marketing or promotion agreements with other browser manufacturers for distribution or promotion of Intuit content. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Were you told in words or in substance in or about April of 1997 that Intuit had agreed not to enter into marketing or promotion agreements with other browser manufacturers for distribution or promotion of Intuit content?
I don't remember being told that.
Do you have any reason to doubt that you were told that?
In the sense that one of the emails that may have come into my mailbox might have related to that, I don't doubt it. I certainly wasn't something that could have been very significant to me because I don't have a recollection of it.
The last Intuit obligation that is listed here is, quote, create differentiated content area for Intuit channel that is available only to IE users, close quote. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Were you told in words or in substance in or about April of 1997 that Intuit had agreed with Microsoft that Intuit would create a differentiated content area for Intuit's channel that would be available only to IE users?
I don't remember being told that, nor do I understand what it means.
Have you ever had any discussions with anyone within Microsoft about the possibility of content providers creating a content area that would only be available to IE users?
I don't understand that. I mean, if the URL is there, you can get to it.
So what you're saying is that this obligation that Intuit is said to have taken on is an obligation that you just don't understand at all what it means. Is that what you're telling me?
I'm saying these words that are on this piece of paper, I don't understand what they mean.
Do you understand the concept?
I don't know what it means.
Okay. Did you ever ask Mr. Poole what it meant?
Nope.
Did you ever ask Mr. Chase what it meant?
No.
Did you ever ask anybody what it meant?
Those words, no.
Or the concept that is described by those words?
I don't understand those words, so it's hard for me to relate to the concept. I don't understand the words.
Let me be sure that I understand what you don't understand. You're telling me that you don't understand what it would mean for Intuit to create a differentiated content area.
That's in quotes.
Yes, for the Intuit channel that would be available only to IE users.
I'm not sure what they mean by that.
Do you have any idea what they mean by that? Let me ask you to look at a document that has been previously marked as Government Exhibit 372. This is a email to you from Ben Slipka, dated April 14th, 1997. Then the subject is, quote, Java review with you, close quote. Did you receive this email in or about April of 1997, Mr. Gates?
I don't remember.
The email begins that the author is working with Paul Moritz to set up a 2 to 3 hour review for you on your Java efforts. Do you see that?
On our Java efforts.
On Microsoft's Java efforts.
No, I think it's Ben Slipka's group.
And he is a Microsoft group, right?
Yeah, he's part of Microsoft, but not all of Microsoft.
So you would interpret this as that he is working with Paul Moritz to set up a 2 to 3 hour review for you of part of Microsoft's Java efforts, but not all of Microsoft's Java efforts. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, the work his group is doing.
The work his group is doing on Java, right?
Right.
Okay. And he lists what he describes as some pretty pointed questions that you, Mr. Gates, had about Java. Did you see that?
I'm not sure those are the pointed questions. It says, I want to make sure I understand your issues, concerns.
Well, that's actually the last part of a sentence that begins, quote, when I met with you last, you had a lot of pretty pointed questions about Java, so I want to make sure I understand your issues, concerns. That's what the sentence says, correct, sir?
Right.
And when Mr. Slifka says, I met with you last, he's talking about you, Mr. Gates, correct, sir?
Yes.
And when he says, you had a lot of pretty pointed questions about Java, he's again talking about you, Mr. Gates, correct?
Right.
And then he lists what he refers to as a start. One, what is our business model for Java? Two, how do we wrest control of Java away from Sun? Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Sometime prior to April 14, 1997, had you conveyed to Mr. Slifka that one of your pointed questions about Java was, quote, how do we wrest control of Java away from Sun?
I don't think I would have put it that way. Certainly was an issue about the popularity of Sun's runtime APIs versus our runtime APIs.
Is it your testimony that you didn't raise the question of how do we wrest control of Java away from Sun with Mr. Slifka?
I'll say again, I doubt I used words like that, but there certainly was an issue of the popularity of our runtime APIs versus their runtime APIs.
Just so the record is clear, I'm not asking you about whether there was a question about the popularity of your runtime APIs or their runtime APIs. What I'm asking is whether you told him in words or in substance that you wanted to know how Microsoft could wrest control or get control of Java away from Sun.
Objection.
I don't remember anything about control in, as a word or in substance, but there was an issue about the popularity of our runtime APIs versus Sun's runtime APIs.
I take it you know Mr. Slifka?
Mm-hmm.
You've got to answer yes or no audibly so the reporter can take it down.
Yes.
And you believe him to be a person of competence and integrity?
Yes.
Do you have any reason to believe that he would have misstated what you told him when you met with him last before April 14th, 1997?
In no way does this purport to be a restatement of things I said to Ben Slifka.
Well, Mr. Gates, what this memorandum says is, quote, when I met with you last, you had a lot of pretty pointed questions about Java, so I want to be sure I understand your issues and concerns. Here's a start. Can you please add any that I'm missing? And then he lists six, the second of which is, how do we wrest control of Java away from Sun? You see that in the exhibit, do you not, sir?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
All right, sir.
Let me ask you to look at a document that has been previously marked as Government Exhibit 373. It's a one-page exhibit, and the second item on the page is a message from you to Paul Moritz, dated June 16, 1997, on the subject of, quote, Java schism, close quote. Did you send this message, Mr. Gates?
I don't remember it, but I don't have any reason to doubt that I did.
What did you mean by, quote, Java schism, close quote?
I think the email speaks for itself.
The email may very well speak to itself or for itself.
I appear to have written a mail that says, a point that is important to me is to have pure Java applications that do a lot have to ship a full runtime instead of being able to count on the runtime being shipped with the operating system, and so on.
Maybe my question wasn't clear. What I'm trying to get you to do is to tell me what you meant by the term Java schism.
It's a heading for this piece of email. The email is the communication, not the heading.
I understand that, sir. What I'm asking is, you chose the heading, did you not, sir?
It appears I typed that.
Right. And why did you choose this heading for this memo? What were you meaning to convey by the term Java schism?
Exactly what I put into the message.
Well, sir, what did you mean by schism?
It explains that in the message.
I'm asking you to explain it in your words. What you mean by the word schism.
I'm drawing a distinction between pure Java apps and where they get their runtime bits.
And is that the schism that you're referring to?
That's what this email is about, and I titled it Java Schism, and I wrote that email. And the question is, how do pure Java applications get their runtime bits?
What is on the two sides of the schism, Mr.?
The bits you get from the browser, the bits you get elsewhere. I mean, the mail couldn't be clearer. It's asking about two sources of the bits. You can get bits from the browser, you can get bits somewhere else.
Okay. Now, where else can you get the bits?
They can ship with the application.
And why was it important to you to have pure Java applications that have the characteristics that you described them here?
I didn't want to have the browser get so large that it would have all the runtime bits for all the applications.
And so where would the bits be?
With the application.
And what you're saying is as important for to you that Microsoft develop pure Java applications that have a lot of bits in them so that those bits don't have to be in the browser. Is that the
case? No. It doesn't say anything about Microsoft developing pure Java applications.
You're right, it doesn't.
And it's clearly not about that.
What is it about then, sir?
It's about pure Java applications in general.
Did you believe that it was desirable to have as many pure Java applications as possible?
It has nothing to do with this email. The answer is no, but okay. If you think it has something to do with this email, that's incorrect.
Okay. I think that it may or may not be productive for you to speculate as to what I think. What I am trying to do is I'm trying to get your testimony about this email and about your views of Java more generally.
I thought so.
And first, let me ask a general question, and that is, did you believe that from Microsoft's standpoint it was desirable to have as many pure Java applications as possible?
We weren't focused on that as a goal, no.
In fact, is it fair to say that you preferred fewer pure Java applications to more pure Java applications?
We preferred more applications that took advantage of our APIs. And so we worked with ISVs to maximize the number that took advantage of our APIs.
And your APIs were not pure Java APIs.
No, some were and some weren't.
Yes, sir, some were and some weren't. But the APIs that you wanted people to use were APIs that were not pure Java APIs, correct, sir?
No, we were glad to have people use both.
Were you indifferent as to whether they used your pure Java APIs or your proprietary APIs?
You've introduced the word proprietary, and that completely changes the question. So help me out. What do you want to know?
Is the term proprietary API a term that you're familiar with, sir?
I don't know what you mean by it.
Is it a term you're familiar with in your business?
I really don't know what you mean. You mean an API that you have a patent on?
Mr. Gates, is the term proprietary API a term that is commonly used in your business?
Let me give you...
All I'm trying to do is get
the common meanings that those words could have, and then you can pick one of them and ask me a question about it.
No,
it
all I'm doing,
do you want me to define proprietary API or
no? I don't want you to define proprietary API. I didn't ask you to define proprietary API. I asked you a simple question as to whether the term proprietary API was commonly used in your business. Now, I'm prepared to sit here as long as you want to answer questions that I haven't asked, but I have a certain number of questions that I'm going to ask at the end of these other answers. Now, this is a simple question. You can say yes, no, or it is used in lots of different ways. But then I can choose what to follow up on. Or you can simply make whatever statements you want, and I'll go back to my question afterwards. Is the term proprietary API a term that is commonly used in your business?
I don't know how common it is. It has many different meanings.
Is it a term that you have used in your business?
Sometimes.
Okay. Now, is it fair to say that when you use the term proprietary APIs, sometimes you mean one thing and sometimes you mean something else?
That's right.
Would you give me the different meanings that you sometimes ascribe to the term proprietary APIs when you use that term?
It can mean an API that only happens to be available from one company. It can mean an API that for some reason related to intellectual property can only be available from one company. And of course, that's never a black and white thing. It can mean an API that somebody's chosen not to take to a standards body. Those are three different things you might mean by it.
I, I just want to be sure that the answer is clear. I'm not asking what I might mean by it or what a person might mean by it. What I'm trying to do is get you to tell me meanings that you ascribe to that term when you use it.
I've used all three of those.
Okay. Are there other meanings that you have ascribed to the term proprietary API in your use of that term?
Not that I can think of right now.
Okay. Now, with respect to the APIs in Windows, there are both Java APIs and non-Java APIs. Is that fair?
I hate to tell you this, but what you mean by Java there is subject to massive ambiguity.
Let me try to put the question this way. In Windows, there are pure Java APIs, there are impure Java APIs, and there are APIs that have nothing to do with Java. Is that fair?
I don't see anything about APIs.
Do you see, Mr. Gates, let me ask you a question. If you can't answer the question, you can't answer the question. Does Windows include pure Java APIs?
In some versions of Windows, there are some Java runtime APIs, which at one time Sun labeled as pure Java APIs. Subsequently, they changed in a way that was not upwards compatible. So it's actually kind of confusing.
Does Windows have any APIs that you would consider to be pure Java APIs?
Today?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess the AWT 1.1 stuff, you might think of that way.
Anything else?
I don't know what you mean, anything else.
Any other APIs in Windows that you would consider to be pure Java APIs, Mr. Gates?
I know there's more. I don't know the technical names for them.
Okay. And does Microsoft have a version of Java that is not what you refer to in your memo as pure Java?
I have no idea what you mean by that question.
Okay. Does Windows include APIs that are written in what is described as a form or version of Java, but not pure Java?
Are you talking about the language?
If you don't understand the question, Mr. Gates, you can simply say you don't understand the question.
Okay, I'm sorry. I don't understand
Good.
The question.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to do. What I'm trying to do is get on the record what you say you understand, what you say you don't understand.
Yeah, many times.
Would you read the answer back, please? Or the statement back?
Are you talking about the language?
No, I'm not talking about the language, if by the language you mean all the things that you said about the Java language when we were talking about Java yesterday. Now let me go back to me asking the questions, if I can. As part of an effort to take control of Java away from Sun, in the terms used by Mr. Slifka in his memo with Mr. Gay to you, dated April 14, 1997, did Microsoft make an effort to get people to use a version of Java APIs that was not pure Java APIs?
I don't understand the question.
Okay. In an attempt to, in Mr. Slifka's words, wrest control of Java away from Sun, did Microsoft make an effort to get programmers to write to APIs that could be used to run applications on Windows, but not on all other operating systems to which a pure Java written program could be run?
I wouldn't say that was part of anything to do with controlling Java, but we do promote the use of the unique Windows APIs.
And with respect to the unique Windows APIs, are some of those APIs that Microsoft describes as Java APIs, or has in the past?
There's a lawsuit with Sun.
Well, there's a lawsuit with Sun, and it's a lawsuit with Sun relating to the use of Java, right?
It relates to a very specific contract that we have with Sun.
And does that very specific contract with Sun relate to Java?
It's a license to various Sun technologies related to Java.
Okay. Now, you're familiar with that lawsuit, are you not, sir?
Not very.
Not very? Do you know what the contentions in that lawsuit are?
No.
Never tried to find out? Is that your testimony?
I haven't read the complaint, if that's your question.
That's not my question. My question is whether you've ever tried to find out the substance of the allegations about Java that Sun is making in its lawsuit against Microsoft.
My understanding of their allegations is very limited.
What is your understanding of their allegations?
I haven't read the contract between Microsoft and Sun.
I'm asking you about the allegations in the complaint, not whether you've read the contract. I'm asking for your understanding, which I know you've already said is very limited, but I'm asking for your understanding of what allegations Sun makes in its claim against Microsoft.
I think there's some dispute about they were supposed to make the test cases public and upwards compatible. And they didn't make them public, and they weren't upwards compatible. And that relates to the contract that I haven't read.
And that's what you think they allege in the complaint?
Well, that those are certain things that they were required to do, I believe.
My question is not about what you believe they were required to do, Mr. Gates. My question is, what is your understanding about the complaint that they make about what you did, about what Microsoft did? Do you understand the question?
You're asking me to summarize their lawsuit?
I'm asking you to tell me what you know about the claims they make in that lawsuit. You said you know something about it, but it's very limited. All I'm trying to do is get you to tell me what it is you know about the claims they make in their lawsuit.
I think they want us to ship J&I.
Is that all you know about their claims?
I think there was something about a trademark.
What about the trademark?
Whether we could use the trademark? I'm not sure.
Don't you know, Mr. Gates, that one of the allegations that they make is that you're taking their trademark and applying it to things that it shouldn't be applied to?
Yeah, I think there's a trademark issue. I'm not sure what they're saying about the trademark.
Do you know anything that they're saying about the trademark, according to your present testimony?
I know there's a dispute about the trademark.
But don't you know that one of the things they're alleging is that Microsoft is taking their trademark and applying it to things it shouldn't be applied to, according to them?
I'm not sure that's right, because I don't think we use their trademark. I'm not sure. I'm kind of confused about that. I've never seen us using their trademark. So I'm a little confused about how that relates to any dispute with Sun.
Did you ever try to find that out?
What?
What the claims were, more than your present knowledge.
I read something that was on our website about 4 days ago.
About the Sun lawsuit?
Yeah, Bob Muglia had some statements.
Other than that, did you ever try to find out what Microsoft is being charged with, what they're alleged to have done wrong?
I've had discussions with Moritz saying, do I need to learn about this lawsuit? Do I need to spend a lot of time on it?
What did he say?
He said, no, he's focused on that, and I can focus on other things.
Is one of the things that you're focused on trying, in Mr. Slifka's words, to wrest control, or get control, if rest is a word that you don't like, of Java away from Sun?
No.
How did you think Microsoft could get control of Java away from Sun?
I honestly don't know what you mean by control of Java. I know those words are in that email from Mr. Slifka, but when you ask me the question, I don't know what you mean, control of Java.
Is your testimony, Mr. Gates, that as you sit here today under oath, you have no idea what Mr. Slifka meant when he said that one of the pointed questions that you had raised with him was how to get control of Java away from Sun?
I told you, I think it related to our attempt to make our runtime APIs the most popular runtime APIs.
And not the Java APIs from Sun. Is that what you're saying?
Well, let's not label the APIs, not the unique ones that Sun was promoting.
When you say the unique ones that Sun was promoting, what were the unique ones that Sun was promoting called?
I'm not sure what they're called. I think AWT 1.2, maybe? Or JDK 1.2?
And is it your best testimony that that's what you think this would have meant back in April of 1997, sir?
That what meant?
Getting control of Java away from Sun. The thing we've been talking about here.
Is that the same as rest control? I mean, you keep reading these words from the email.
I'm trying to get away from the word rest because you say you don't remember that exact word, so I'm trying to use a word that is more neutral, like get or obtain control.
I've told you I can't understand what's meant by control there. I know that we're trying to make our APIs popular with developers.
How does making your APIs popular with developers relate to obtaining control of Java, if at all?
I don't know what it means to control Java. How can somebody control Java? What does that mean?
Is it your testimony that you have no idea what that means?
To control Java? I don't think anyone can control Java. It's like saying controlling BASIC or COBOL.
Do you really mean that, sir?
Yes.
I'm going to press this just another 30 seconds, and then I will stop. But I really do want to be sure that I have given you a full and fair opportunity. Is it your testimony that as you sit here today under oath that you have no idea what is meant by control of Java as used in this email to you by Mr. Slifka?
I've said several times I think he must be referring to our effort to make our APIs the most popular APIs, but that wouldn't give us control of Java. So it's I'm having a hard time relating it to the specific words.
Well, without relating it to the specific words, how would getting people to use your APIs get control of Java? Why do you relate those two in your mind?
Because he probably means the Java runtime, not Java.
Let's say he means the Java runtime.
Then he's talking about the competition of APIs.
Is it fair to say, Mr. Gates, that you interpret this as how does Microsoft can get, obtain control of Java runtime? Is that what you're saying?
I think that's the most likely explanation of what he meant. I still don't understand the word control there because it's not the word I'd use.
Well, according to Mr. Slifka, it is the word you used, is it not, sir?
We've already been through that.
But looking at this doesn't refresh your recollection about having used that word?
It does not.
Have you ever said in words or in substance to anyone that you wanted to obtain control over Java or over Java runtimes?
I don't remember using those words.
Do you remember conveying that concept or conveying that substance?
If by that concept you mean conveying the idea that we wanted our runtime APIs to be the most popular, then the answer is yes.
Why did you want your runtime APIs to be the most popular?
By having our runtime APIs be the most popular, it means that people are more likely to license Windows because there's applications that take advantage of the unique innovations that are in the Windows product.
Why does the fact that there are applications that take advantage of the unique APIs that are in the Windows product make people more likely to license Windows?
Because it shows off the unique innovations of Windows.
How does it show off the unique innovations of Windows?
Well, let's say, for example, they call our tasking APIs, then it shows off the unique way that we've done tasking. Let's say they call our clipboard APIs. Then it shows off the advances we've made in data exchange, which are very advanced.
Is it your testimony that trying to get applications writers to write to Windows' own APIs was something that you were trying to do only for the reasons that you've identified?
Well, I think there's additional reasons as well.
Isn't it a fact, Mr. Gates, that one of the reasons that you were trying, that Microsoft was trying to get control over the Java runtimes, or Java as it's described in Mr. Slifka's memorandum, was to prevent Java or Java runtimes from supporting competition with Windows?
And by control? That means I don't understand the question.
Okay. Did you ever participate in any discussions within Microsoft as to the extent to which Java or Java runtimes posed a threat to Microsoft's position with respect to the Windows platform?
Yeah, I've already told you that there came a point where we viewed Sun's unique Java runtime APIs as a part of the competitive environment, a competitor.
Okay. Now, why were the Java APIs from Sun a competitor?
Well, if people just use the least common denominator APIs, then they don't show off the innovations that we're doing in Windows, and it makes it less attractive to people to license Windows or update Windows.
Now, what I'm trying to do, and you may think you've answered this question, but I don't think the record makes it clear in any event, what I'm trying to do is distinguish between that reason, which you've given me a couple times, and any other reason that may exist. Do you understand what I'm asking?
No.
Okay. let me try it again. Isn't it true, Mr. Gates, that in addition to whatever desire you may have had to show off your Windows capabilities that you say you had, that one of the things that was going on here was your trying, Microsoft's trying, to prevent Java from getting wide enough distribution so that it could support applications programming for platforms other than Windows?
No.
Not at all, sir?
There's no limitation of distribution.
Didn't ask whether there's any limitation of distribution. I asked you whether in any way the desire to prevent Java from developing applications that could be used on platforms other than Windows motivated what Microsoft was doing in connection.
Does it mean Java developing applications?
I actually didn't recall that I'd used that phrase.
Can you read me the question?
That in addition to whatever desire you may have had to show off your Windows capabilities that you say you have, that one of the things that was going on here was your trying, Microsoft's trying, to prevent Java from getting wide enough distribution so that it could support applications programming for platforms other than Windows. Answer, no. Not at all, sir. Answer, there's no limitation of distribution. Question, didn't ask whether there was any limitation of distribution. I asked whether you in any way the desire... I asked you whether in any way the desire to prevent Java from developing applications that could be used on platforms other than Windows motivated what Microsoft was doing in connection with Java.
Can you answer that question, Mr. Gates? If you can't, I'll rephrase it. But if you can answer it, I'd like to.
I don't know what you mean, Java developing applications.
Isn't it a fact, Mr. Gates, that in addition to whatever other reasons you say you had for what you did with Java and Windows APIs, part of what you were trying to do was to prevent Java from having a wide enough distribution so that it could support programs that could be used on platforms other than Windows?
We had no way of preventing Java from being used on other platforms. It is used on other platforms.
That wasn't my question, sir. My question is whether or not part of what you and Microsoft was trying to do was to limit the distribution of Java sufficiently so that you could thereby limit or reduce the extent to which applications were written that could be used on platforms other than Windows.
No. In fact, we sell the most popular Java tools in the market.
It is your testimony then, sitting here, that Microsoft was not at all motivated by a desire to limit the extent to which Java could be used to develop applications programming that could be used on platforms other than Microsoft's Windows. Is that your testimony?
Yes.
Did Microsoft believe that Netscape's browser was a means of distributing Java APIs?
Well, Netscape had some APIs in its browser. I'm not sure if you'd refer to them as Java APIs or not.
It's not a question whether I would refer to them that way or not, Mr. Gates. What I'm asking you is what you and Microsoft believe. And my question is, did you and others at Microsoft believe that Netscape's browser was a method for distributing Java APIs?
There were APIs in the Netscape browser. I don't think they were strictly Java APIs, or even in a direct sense specifically.
Have you completed your answer, sir?
Mm-hmm.
Could I have the question read back again?
It's not a question if I would refer to them that way or not, Mr. Gates. What I'm asking you is what you and Microsoft believe And my question is, did you and others at Microsoft believe that Netscape's browser was a method for distributing Java APIs?
Can you tell me that, sir?
There were APIs in the Netscape browser, some of which, under some definition of Java APIs, you'd call Java APIs.
And was there concern within Microsoft that the distribution of these things that you say could be called Java APIs would adversely affect Microsoft?
Our concern is always to get people to develop Windows applications, and to the degree there's other APIs people to develop to, there's some competition for the attention of developers in focusing on those APIs, but that doesn't relate to distribution.
Could I have my question read back again, please?
And was the concern within in Microsoft the distribution of these things that you say could be called Java APIs would adversely affect Microsoft?
Could I have an answer to that question, please, sir?
No, not the distribution.
Let me ask you to look at a document that has been previously marked as Government Exhibit 349. The first message in this exhibit is an email from Paul Moritz to you and a number of other people dated July 14, 1997. Correct, sir?
That's what appears to be, yes.
Did you receive this email, sir?
I don't remember it, but I don't have any reason to doubt that I did.
Mr. Moritz writes to you in the third sentence, quote, if we look further at Java / JFC being our major threat, then Netscape is the major distribution vehicle. Do you see that, sir?
Mm-hmm.
Do you recall Mr. Moritz telling you in words or in substance that Netscape was the major distribution vehicle for the Java / JFC threat to Microsoft?
No.
Did you believe in July of 1997 that Java / JFC was a major threat to Microsoft, as Mr. Ritz writes here?
It was in significant issue for his group in terms of RSVs would choose to focus their development in the future.
Did you believe in July of 1997 that Java / JFC was a major threat to Microsoft?
In the form that it existed as of that day, maybe not, but if we looked at how it might be evolved in the future, we did think of it as something that competed with us for the attention of ISVs in terms of whether or not they would take advantage of the advanced features of Windows.
Do you have any understanding as to what Mr. Moritz meant when he wrote to you about Java, JFC, being a major threat to Microsoft?
Yeah, I just answered that.
What did you understand Mr. Moritz to mean when he says Java, JFC, was Microsoft's major threat?
I just answered that.
You'll have to give me an answer, Mr. Gates, because if you did answer it, it's not an answer that I can understand how it applies to the particular question I'm asking.
I said we looked at how the various runtime APIs, which it was always confusing, you know, where they were going and what they were doing, and JFC is just a term for some of those, how they might evolve in a way that would take away the focus of developers in terms of writing applications that would take unique advantage of Windows features.
I understand that you say that that was an issue for you. Why was that a major threat to Microsoft, if you have any understanding?
Well, if people stopped writing applications that took advantage of Windows runtime APIs, that would mean that users wouldn't have access to the innovative features that we were putting into Windows.
Why was that a major threat to Microsoft?
If ISVs weren't writing applications to take unique advantage of Windows, then it wouldn't show off the Windows innovation, and so users wouldn't have much reason to update Windows or to license any new versions of Windows.
You referred to JFC in a couple answers ago, and of course that's here in the memo. What does JFC stand for, as you understand it?
I was always a little confused about that, and it changed over time. It stands for Java Foundation Classes.
Mr. Moritz writes here that Netscape is the major distribution vehicle for Java and Java Foundation Classes. Do you see that?
That's at the end of that sentence.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You see that?
Yes.
Now, in a prior answer, you said you didn't understand how the browser was a distribution vehicle. Does this refresh your recollection that at least within Microsoft in July of 1997, Netscape was viewed as the major distribution vehicle for Java?
Not for Java. And in my view, the browser wasn't a key distribution channel. Moritz may or may not have agreed with that, but you can always ship the runtime with the applications.
Mr. Moritz here says Netscape is the major distribution vehicle. Now, it's clear to you, is it not, sir, that he means the major distribution vehicle for Java and Java Foundation Classes?
He doesn't mean for Java.
Well, sir, he says,
I've told you many times about the use of the word Java, and I'm not sure you heard me. When people use the word Java, they don't mean just Java.
So when Mr. Moritz here used the word Java in this email that you say you don't recall receiving, you're telling me that he meant something other than just Java.
I bet he meant some runtime APIs, not Java.
Let's assume that you're right. Let's assume that when he talks about Java, he means Java runtime APIs. Would you then agree that what he is saying here is that Netscape is the major distribution vehicle for Java runtime APIs and Java foundation classes?
That appears to be what he's saying in this email.
And Mr. Gates, what was Mr. Moritz's title on July 14th, 1997?
I think Group Vice President.
What was he Group Vice President of?
I don't know what the title would have said after that, but he managed the group that contained all of our Windows activities.
Was he Group Vice President for platforms?
I'm not sure. I'm sure if it contained the word platforms, it didn't just say platforms, because he's got Office and some other things also.
But within his responsibilities would have been Windows.
That's right.
Let me ask you to look at a document that has been marked as Government Exhibit 374.
Thank you.
This is an email to you from Todd Nielsen, dated August 25, 1997, with copies to Brad Chase. Did you receive this email, sir?
I don't remember receiving it, but I don't have any reason to doubt that I did.
Let me ask you to look at the seventh paragraph down. It's the third paragraph from the bottom. The last sentence that says, quote, "So we are just proactively trying to put obstacles in Sun's path and get anyone that wants to write in Java to use J/direct and target Windows directly." Close quote. You see that, sir?
Mm-hmm.
Do you recall being told in or about August of 1997 that Microsoft was trying to put obstacles in Sun's path and get anyone that wants to write in Java to use J/direct and target Windows directly?
No.
Do you know why Microsoft was trying to put, quote, obstacles in Sun's path, close quote?
I don't know what that means.
Do you know why Microsoft was trying to get anyone that wants to write in Java to use J/direct?
Yes.
Why was that?
Because J/direct allows you to make calls that show off the unique innovations in Windows and therefore make Windows more attractive.
Was there any reason other than that Microsoft wanted to get anyone that wants to write in Java to use J/direct?
Yes.
What?
Well, there's a benefit to us if people are showing off Windows and it increases Windows popularity. That helps us with the other applications we write for Windows as well, including Microsoft Office.
How is that so?
Because Microsoft Office is targeted to Windows, we get a benefit that goes even beyond increased sales of Windows if we manage to popularize Windows.
Why is that?
Because they can buy Office.
Well, they can buy Office and use it on the Mac, too, can't they? Since you didn't cancel Mac Office.
We have a much wider set of applications available for the Windows platform than any other platform. And we have more frequent updates of products like Office on the Windows platform. It's a more powerful version, the Windows version, and it therefore our revenue per unit is somewhat higher.
You mean the version of Office for Windows is more powerful than the version of Office for Mac, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, we have Office Pro.
What is J Direct?
J Direct is a way of allowing Java language code to call native OS functionality. It's a fairly clever thing that we have done, and others now use that term to refer to it when they let their OS functionality show through as well.
You have referred to Java runtimes. Are there J Direct runtimes?
There's a thunk, but I don't know if you'd call it a runtime or not. It's a thunk.
Would you define for me what the difference is in your mind between a thunk and a runtime?
A thunk is a small piece of runtime that remaps parameters and calling conventions in such a way to be able to pass along an API call to another piece of runtime.
When was J Direct developed by Microsoft?
I'm not sure.
Approximately.
I don't know. I mean,
why was J Direct developed by Microsoft?
To make it easy for people who choose the Java language to call the unique runtime features in various operating systems, including Windows.
Why do you want people to write in J Direct as opposed to Java?
They are writing in Java. You only use J Direct if you write in Java.
What Mr. Nielsen says is that Microsoft is trying to get anyone that wants to write in Java to use J Direct. Do you see that?
That's right. And that means writing in Java.
And why do you want to get anyone who wants to write in Java to use J Direct?
Because that gives them a way of calling unique Windows APIs that allow us to show off the innovative features in Windows.
Couldn't you do that by having them simply write in Java and you providing the thunk separately?
The name of the thunk is J Direct. I guess we could have another thunk and call it something other than J Direct, and that would be another way that they could do it. But we didn't choose to do it twice.
No, you didn't choose to do it twice. That's not my question, Mr. Gates. My question is why you were trying to get program developers, independent programming people, to use J Direct. Why were you trying to get them to do that?
Sir, because it allows them to get at the unique API functionality that's in the Windows product and show off the innovations that we do there.
But you didn't have to.
Tell me some other way.
Well, I'm asking you. If you tell me that that's what you say is the only way that you could think of for them to do it, that's your testimony. I don't get to testify here. If I did, there have been a lot of things that I would have said along the way. But since I don't get to testify, all I get to do is ask you questions.
And my question to you is whether there was a way that you were aware of at the time to let people see all of what you refer to as the functionality of Windows without getting people to write to what you refer to here to use JDirect if they wanted to write in Java.
JDirect is exactly the work we did to make it possible and reasonable for people writing in Java to call the unique Windows APIs.
Have you finished your answer?
Yes.
Okay. Now, were you aware of other ways of accomplishing the same result that you considered and rejected at the time?
What time is that?
The time that you developed JDirect.
We don't know what that time is.
Well, you may not know the exact year, but do you know that when, were you aware when JDirect was being developed within Microsoft? Were you aware of it at the time?
I'm not sure.
Did you know it was being developed?
I'm not sure.
Did you have any discussions about the development of JDirect at the time it was being developed?
I was not involved in the design of JDirect.
Not asking you whether you were involved in the design of JDirect. I'm asking you whether you were aware at the time that JDirect was being developed that it was being developed.
I'm not sure.
Did you ever have any discussions with anyone about the development of JDirect at or about the time it was being developed?
I don't think so.
At the time that JDirect was being developed, did you know that people were trying to develop JDirect?
It's just a thunk.
My question is, did you know that they were trying to develop this thunk?
I doubt it.
Did you participate at all in any discussions as to what alternatives there were to the development of JDirect?
Before it was developed?
Let's start with before it was developed.
No, I don't think so.
What about during the time it was being developed?
I don't think so.
How about after it was developed?
I don't think so.
Let me show you a document that's been previously marked as Government Exhibit 378. In the middle of the first page, there is a message dated May 14, 1997 from Ben Slifka to you and others. Did you receive this email on or about May 14, 1997?
I'm not sure, but I have no reason to doubt that I did.
When Mr. Slifka writes, as he does in the second paragraph, "This summer we're going to totally divorce Sun," do you know what he's referring to?
I'm not sure.
Did you ever ask him what he was referring to?
No.
Next to last or in the last sentence actually, in the last sentence of the second paragraph, Mr. Slifka writes that JDK 1.2 has JFC, and is the JFC there the Java Foundation classes that you referred to earlier?
It's one of the many JFCs.
What is one of the many JFCs?
The one in JDK 1.2.
Is the JFC in JDK 1.2 a part of what was described as a major threat to Microsoft?
I have no idea which JFC that sentence written by somebody other than me referred to?
Well, the sentence written by somebody other than you was written to you, right, sir?
It was sent to me.
Yes. And it was sent to you by one of your chief executives, one of your top executives, correct, sir?
In an email.
Yes. And that's a frequent way that your top executives communicate with you, correct, sir?
Yes.
Now, Mr. Slifka here says that Microsoft is going to be saying uncomplimentary things about JDK 1.2 at every opportunity. Do you see that?
What's that?
That is JDK 1.2 has JFC, which we're going to be pissing on at every opportunity.
I don't know if he's referring to pissing on JFC or pissing on JDK 1.2, nor do I know what he specifically means by pissing on.
Well, do you know that generally he means by pissing on, he's going to be saying, and Microsoft is going to be saying uncomplimentary things?
It might mean that we're going to be clear that we're not involved with it, that we think there's a better approach.
Well, as you understand it, when Mr. Slifka says he's going to be pissing on JDK 1.2, as you seem to interpret it, at every opportunity, do you interpret that as meaning that Microsoft is going to be saying uncomplimentary things about JDK 1.2?
I told you I don't know whether pissing applies to JFC or JDK.
Well, he's going to be pissing on, or Microsoft's going to be pissing on, either JDK 1.2 or JFC or both, according to Mr. Slifka. Is that at least fair?
That's it appears to be what the sentence says.
Yeah. And as the chief executive officer of Microsoft, when you get these kind of emails, would it be fair for me to assume that pissing on is not some kind of code word that means saying nice things about, but has the usual meaning that it would in the vernacular?
I don't know what you mean, this kind of email.
The kind of email that is sent to you by executives in the course of your business, Mr. Gates.
So all emails I get? Ben Slifka is not an executive.
All the emails you get from people telling you that they're going to piss on competitive products. That's what I'm talking about.
I don't remember mail like that. It looks like I got one, but believe me, it's not a term that's commonly used.
Okay, but you have no reason to think that he means it in any way other than the normal meaning of that term, do you, sir?
I think it's a term with multiple meanings. In this case, I think it means what you've suggested it means.
Okay. I thought it did, too, and I hope to avoid actually going through the actual language. Okay, let me... Mr. Gates, let me show you a document that has been previously marked as Government Exhibit 377. The second email here refers to what is attached as a final copy of the memo that was sent
to you for Think Week in November 1995. Do you recall receiving this document, sir?
Now, what I recall about this document is that it's already been marked as an exhibit and that I spoke with Mr. Houck about it yesterday.
That may be so. My question to you is, do you recall receiving this make it simple. Did you receive this memo in or about November of 1995?
As I said before, for my Think Weeks, I get about 3 cardboard boxes of materials that people put together for me. And in looking at this memo, it's not a memo that I'd seen before Mr. Houck's depositions questions put to me yesterday.
So it's your testimony, the first time you saw this document was when Mr. Houck showed it to you yesterday?
That's right. It had a different exhibit number then.
Let me ask you to go to page 5 of the document, which bears in the bottom right-hand corner the Microsoft document production number ending 4683.
Okay.
Do you see the heading Shell Integration?
Yes.
Do you see the second sentence where it says, we will bind the shell to the Internet Explorer so that running any other browser is a jolting experience?
I see that.
Do you have any understanding as to what was meant by that?
I can guess.
First, this is in a memo that is entitled, How to Get 30% Share in 12 Months. Correct?
Let's take a look. Yeah, that's on the first page.
And is it clear to you that that is referring to getting a 30% share of the browser market?
I haven't read the document, but it seems likely that's what it is.
Okay. Now, do you have an understanding? I'm not asking you to guess, but do you have an understanding as to what is meant by the statement, we will bind the shell to the Internet Explorer so that running any other browser is a jolting experience?
I don't know what he meant by it, but I can tell you what it likely means.
Okay. I take it this is really how you would have interpreted this when you received it. Is that fair?
I didn't read it, so...
I said if you had received it, this is how you would interpret it.
I said I didn't read it. I would have read the whole memo if I'd received it. I wouldn't have turned to that page and just looked at that one sentence. I would have read the memo from the beginning, page by page, and then I probably would have understood it better than I do at this moment.
If you do not have an understanding of what is meant by it, you can tell me. If you do have an understanding of what is meant by it, I would like to have it.
I don't know what he meant by it, but I'd be glad to guess as to what it might mean.
I don't want you to guess, but if you, as the chief executive officer of Microsoft, can tell me how you would, in the ordinary course of your business, interpret this statement, I would like to have you do so.